fortunate enough to introduce to you all Mr. G.K.Pillai, the Managing Director and CEO at Walchandnagar Industries Ltd, Pune. I would request you to please share with us all your words of wisdom. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. Dr. Archana Srivastav, the Director of BIMM, other senior faculty members of the various sister concerns, sister institutions of the Balaji Group, students who are present here, other faculty members, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure there'll be no press, so I don't have to talk about them. How many of you would have ever gone to an exam hall and you find that the question paper, what has come, is either out of syllabus So, I am in that situation today. I have come prepared. Well, I was told that the topic is very interesting, emerging challenges in the business environment. And it's a national seminar. So maybe either the student didn't understand the syllabus correctly, like me, I'm a student here, I've come to write the exam. So I was under the impression that there will be more practicing managers who will be having experience in running their businesses or working in various capacities. So my presentation was perhaps slightly dovetailed towards them. But when I was talking to Dr. Archana Srivastav just before I came up, then she mentioned that it's a great bunch of students. So I thought, I was just having the same situation, I come unprepared. But she did see my anxiety, and it was very nice of her to immediately say, no, don't worry. She has got a lot of aspirations and hopes about all of you. She says, my students are as good as practicing managers. So that's a compliment to all of you. So let's give a compliment to the students first. I will try to make this a little bit more interesting. See, when you talk to a practicing manager, it's a different way of talking. When you talk to a student, I know the student would love to listen something different. Not like what a practicing manager would love to listen. I will try my best. The topic is very interesting. The topic is very large. The topic is very wide. And the topic is very relevant. Today, it's very relevant. When we talk about business and the challenges in the business environment, what is a business and what are the challenges? Most of you, as I understand, are students of management, different streams of management, could be an HR, could be finance, could be international marketing. She was mentioning even telecom. I'm hearing for the first time, telecom management. So all of you are students of business management, if I may put it that way. And today or tomorrow, you will be facing ground realities which are never taught in a textbook, which are never envisaged, and the rate of pace of change of the happenings around us today is so fast that by the time you finish one, you're able to hear? Okay. The rate of change is so fast that one has to really keep pace. You have to be like somebody who is to run very fast. 100 meters. So let's come back to the what is the business and what is the challenge. Some years back, I am from the vintage model. Perhaps I was just looking into the hall, and I thought there may be no. I do not know about your Professor Balasubramaniam Saab. Otherwise, I should be perhaps the oldest man in this hall today, having almost touched 66 years old, and having a working experience of almost 44, 45 years. So right from the day 21, I am on the job. When we started the business, when we started working, the business environment was different, and the rate of change was so slow, you can even catch it because it's so slow. I started my career in a company I was just telling in Kerala, 1973. 21 years in one company. Today my own daughter says, how can you live in a place like Palghat and work for 21 years? And that is the change. That itself is the first change in business. You, in the earlier days, I will talk about the actual changes. The earlier days, the change never used to happen in terms of people, in terms of HR. No. The change used to happen in terms of maybe technology. And that too, technology used to be very slow in changing. I don't think any of the students may be aware that in the automobile sector, we used to have two models, the ambassador car and the Fiat or the Premier Padmini or any of those cars. It never changed. It never changed for years. And today the thing has changed. It's changing almost every month you find a model. And if you want to buy an automobile today, it's quite difficult. You have to go on checking what are the specifications, what are the price, what is the longevity, et cetera, et cetera. So the change in business scenario, business environment, and the challenges are really changed today. Let me talk, what are the basic changes what we have? Oh, what are the challenges? One, technology. Second, macroeconomic. Third, financial. And fourth, human resources. Before I take this, I want to tell a real life incident. It's not a story. It's a real life incident. I graduated from BITS Pilani in 73 and straight went into this job in a company called Instrumentation Limited, which is the public sector government of India. In those days, India became a little bit, globalization came into the country only in 1991. Till 1991, most of the companies, except barring a few private sectors, most of the cream, if I may say, used to go to the public sectors. So when I graduated and I came, I was offered, training of 6 months, I was offered a placement in the sales and marketing department. And I said, no, I don't want sales and marketing. You know, the feeling is sales and marketing is, you know, you have to just go on bluffing something. That is the impression you used to get. And having done an engineering of 5 years in BITS Pilani, I thought the most important thing is technology, technical research and development. And I said, I will like to do research and development only. I don't want sales and marketing. Fine. They put me in research and development. 6 months I was there. And after 6 months, when the placement was once again, discussions were held, they said, why don't you go to sales and marketing? Then I was very reluctant. So I decided. So the general manager who was there, he tried to sell that job to me. I was a young boy, 21, 22 years old. And what he says in any organization, only two people matter. One who sells and one who makes. Rest. So in any organization, there are only two people who matter, one who sells and one who makes, and rest all others are actually running errands for these two people. It's a fact. If you really look at it, it's a fact. Be it materials management, be it supply chain, be it HR, be it finance, ultimately these are the two. And between these two, who is more important? Somebody said? Why? The man who said, the student who said, come, anyone. Why? You are the one who is? Okay, I will not counter you now. At a later time, I'll counter you. Okay, good. There can be plenty of reasons. I'm talking, please understand, in 1973 framework. That's very important for you to understand. The gentleman who wanted to sell me the idea, his point was very clear. He says, there are two people. The man who makes, he has to make something, no? If he has to make this pointer, he has to make a pointer. And the man who sells, he can even sell ideas. He doesn't have to make anything. And people, you know, even today in the whole country or even in the whole world, people sell ideas and they fleece people. Okay, I'm not going into a Ram Rahim or anybody else, but they are sellers. Selling does not mean you'd only sell a product. Selling is even an idea. So the logs, the story is, I was actually attracted to this sales and marketing. It's a different story. I'm not going into that. I will come to this part a bit later on, end of my talk. So this story is important to remember now. And in the end of my talk, I'll again bring this point. So these are the four challenges, as I said. Technology. Now you see, the change in technology is so fast today that we really can't even imagine how fast. And if you do not change in technology, you get killed. And there are innumerable examples in the world, in the life, starting from, again, a vintage company. Like, there used to be a company called ITI, Indian Telephone Industries. At one time, ITI was one of the premier government public sector companies making telephone instruments. To get a telephone connection was difficult. To get a telephone instrument was equally difficult. And ITI was in the prime. But because the technology, they did not change, they got killed, and they are almost today not even existing. If you look at the today's recent companies, not changing the technology, not accepting the challenges, not facing the challenges, we have cases of BlackBerry. Everybody knows how BlackBerry came. It was one of the most coveted gadgets. All top business executives used to carry the BlackBerry, thinking that that is the only gadget available. But the technology changed. And there are innumerable examples of how the technology changes. And these disruptions can wipe out the existing business and models overnight. It can just go away. So one of the challenges which you as a student tomorrow is going, when you enter the business, one of the points when I was talking to Dr. Srivastava, she was telling me, perhaps the students would like to know how to face such challenges. So one important aspect which you should know when you enter your professional career is the days ahead is you will be facing changes, challenges in technology, which is a must. Technology is the driver of growth. Nothing else is the driver of growth. The driver of growth is technology. And if the technology is not up to date, you cannot today sell a product. The rate of evolution is phenomenal. I already said, there are cases like 3D printing is there. Composites is a new material, which is absolutely different. You know, about 10 years or 15, just 10 years back, during a global conference, it was felt that in the world, if there will be some problem of an item, and that is metals, that is castings. But today, the requirement of castings itself is actually will become obsolete because we are going to have more items like composites, etc. Robotics is another area which is definitely a challenge because at some time, we used to think that a skill of an operator is very, very important. But today, you find that with robotics, it's a different type of challenge. You may have a very skilled person, but that's of no use. Ultimately, the technology habit changes. Similarly, in the business arena, the changes which technology brings is in terms of, we all know what is the mobile commerce, we all know what are the analytics, and the data. So the whole important aspect which is very critical is, in today's business scenario, there is nothing constant. People used to even earlier say, change is the only constant. Yes, we all know that. But the way, the rate of change, the acceleration in which the change happens today is phenomenal. So another aspect which is very, very challenging for you is the life cycle of a product. The product life cycle today, by the time the product is even established, the whole thing gets over. We are all aware about the way the mobile phones, it's sometimes so confusing, we really do not know which is the most modern or which is the most latest model in the mobile, because it's so fast it gets extinct that you, by the time you buy it, you think that it has become a second model. So due to the rapid evolution of technology, product life cycles have crashed. Now organizations have to constantly innovate to stay relevant in the marketplace. Underlying systems and processes are very, very important. Both the manufacturing and services are affected by the ongoing technology revolution. Now, I'm sure most of you today who are sitting in this hall, I do not know, how many of you would be having an engineering background and doing a management? Can you raise the hands? Oh. Almost more than 50%. Not bad. So, whether you are in the manufacturing sector or whether you are in the service sector, the technology revolution is going to affect a lot. People used to think that only the technology revolution will affect only the manufacturing sector. No, but we see today the service sector, even in the service sector, the amount of change which happens and so rapidly happens that in both these sectors, the executives, the students who are going to become executives there will have to face those challenges for you to succeed or for you to really even establish yourself for years ahead. So that was technology. I didn't want to talk much about technology. Macroeconomic environment. You look at some years back when you used to have a business, whatever business you have, whether the business is of a manufacturing item or whether the business of a retail item, you think that, oh, I have a fixed customer. But today what happens is the globe is your customer. And you become part of a customer for somebody else, be it China, be it Russia, be it America. For them, you are a customer. So the macroeconomic environment changes, which earlier was we never used to feel the effect of that, is definitely today going to change a lot. So the global events, earlier when there was any global event, we never knew will it impact us? No. But today you know that every single event anywhere in the world, even in a small country across the globe, there will be an impact. A company like mine, recently there was elections in Kenya. If you are up to date with what is happening across the world, I'm sure the international business students will be aware. At least they should be aware. There was an election in Kenya, and where, if you again know, there used to be one gentleman called Jomo Kenyatta. He used to be the president of Kenya for a very long time, almost 20, 25 years. Then his son was the president for the last 15 years. And this election, which was just over about a month and a half back, his son, the junior Kenyatta, won. But there was a lot of opposition, that the news was that the votes were rigged, etc., the usual things. And there was some sort of a clash in Kenya on a presidential election. but the vibrations of that has affected my company. The vibrations, because we do business globally, we have a unit there, we have a site there, people, the projects get affected. So what I'm saying is any global event today is going to make a big impact on the business scenario, what you do. You suddenly find that, yes, you may be aware, many of you may be aware, Qatar suddenly, just about 2 months back, in the month of May, there's a lot of embargo on Qatar by the other Arab nations. The people who do business with Qatar, or people or Qatarians who are having some connections here, is going to impact us a lot, apart from the people who have been traveling a lot. So the global scenario, geopolitical events across the globe, is going to make an impact. With President Trump's election, earlier US President's election was, okay, we only know, yes, he is one or he is not one. But today it's really making a deep impact. Most of our software industry is impacted on account of this. So this is a very important uncertainty, which again one has to face. Key policy level changes, again, as I talked about, I'm talking about the macroeconomic, area. Key policy changes, whether it's a matter of a GST. You could see some of the small shopkeepers, because they're not totally aware what is a GST and how it is going to impact. They were a bit confused. Are, kya hoga? What will happen? Will I get business? Will I not get business? Similarly, the demonetization. So all these impacts, when I'm talking about business, I'm not only talking about the large business houses, because even small business houses, even you may start your own business of a single proprietor business. So these do make a big impact. A Make in India. It's a great initiative, where a lot of emphasis is being brought into manufacturing of various items in India, which hitherto we have been importing it. So any of these aspects are definitely going to make a big impact in the today's business scenario. So first was technology, second was macroeconomic. The third is financial challenges. You know, for running a business, definitely one of the most important aspects, as we all know, most of you who are in the management, you will find that, yes, financial challenges are very, very, very crucial, very, very critical. Debt, you know, money today, if you ask any businessman, what is his biggest challenge? And I'm sure he'll say money. Money is available, but getting money is difficult. Money is available, but at very high interest rates. So what happens is Indian corporates, Indian business scenario are actually getting worried on account of the high percentage of debts in the balance sheets. So this again is a big challenge. How the, you know, most of the business houses, most of the people who work in the accounts and finance department go on watching what is going to happen today. Is RBI going to make any changes in the fiscal policy? If this, with these changes, how it is going to impact my company, my business, my customers, etc. So you can't be just, you know, elusive that, oh, it's not going to have an impact on me. It does have an impact. And these problems are there in terms of financing, not, as I said, for small companies, large companies, very large companies, steel, engineering, real estate. We know the impact of real estate which has happened. So the financial or the economic situation is equally a very critical one. Non-performing assets, which we all know today, the banks are very tight. The Reserve Bank is very tight. All the Indian banks are has become very tough with either lending or at the same time for repayment, if the repayment is not done. So that is again impacting the business. It's again a challenge. And banks are faced with a lot of NPAs. If you may be working yourself for a bank, and I'm sure that will also have a lot of repercussions in case of such NPAs, etc. The distinction between a willful defaulter or a real genuine business related up and down. Those things are not there. So these are some of the, I have not touched the HR, which I'll come to the last. So how organizations are addressing these financial issues? So one, yes, we have to sale of non-core assets, rationalization of business portfolio. See, if we are faced in a challenge like this, you have to really change the whole scenario. The rationalization of business portfolio, cost rationalization, structured financing, operations and productivity improvement. So the challenge is what you will face tomorrow when you enter a business, when you enter your professional world. It will be on a continuous basis. So the three challenges, as I said, one, technology, two, macroeconomic across the globe, three, financial challenge. The most important challenge, as far as I am concerned, you know, these are challenges which everybody faces. If I am a mobile phone manufacturer, I have the same challenge as far as technology is concerned like any others. But a real challenge today, where you come in the picture, where you have an opportunity, where you can really make a mark, where an institution like yours can really make a difference, is in this. The challenges today, I come from an industry. I know what are the challenges what we have. If there is a technology challenge, we work over the technology. If there is a financial challenge, we work towards that, to overcome that. If a macroeconomic things are happening, we try to dovetail ourselves to see to it that we are, you know, like the Kenya incident happened, we have to make some changes immediately. But the most important thing in any sector, which will come to the story what I started also, is human resources. And this is an area where the least importance is given. I'm telling you, honestly I'm telling you. People will spend money on getting a high-tech technology from a Switzerland or US or anywhere, or Germany. You'll spend money. You'll spend a lot of amount in training. But the human resources is an area. I'm taking a little bit more time on human resources because this is ultimately the, you know, the differentiator between a successful company and an unsuccessful company. You know, one of the points which I say in terms of human resources is we all say we have got people. People will reel out statistics that below 35 years of age, we have got 65% people. Maybe fact. Maybe fact. These are the census numbers. Below 25%, 25 years of age, we have got so many, 75% of people. Now, what is interesting is today's topic is emerging challenges in the business scenario. That is it. That's basically the topic. And as I said, out of the 3 points, I'm again repeating, the technology challenge, macroeconomic challenge, financial challenge, these are challenges which can actually be overcome. Overcome. The challenge which we think is most simple is human resources, which is the most difficult. Which is most difficult. Today I'll tell you, you know, lot of places where people talk, skill development. There is a very, you know, buzzword. Skill development. We had to spend so much money on skill development. Whose skill are we developing? What are we doing for that skill development? You know, we suddenly will say, oh, this low, you know, maybe a welder, maybe a fitter. We only talk about that. The most important thing is the skill development of people sitting in this room. And I am at various forums, I am always saying that we only talk about skill development of the labor class, to see to it that they get some vocational training and they can get involved into the certain organ that is needed. I'm not saying no. But the challenge in the scenario, business scenario today, is how people like you are actually dovetailed, are actually trained, are actually skilled. Skilled is the word I'm using to meet the challenges. And that, I'm sure, the way little bit what I walked through your campus today, I'm very confident that you will be giving a lot of developmental arenas for the students to face the challenges. And this is what is required. Though India has ample number of engineering management graduates, how many are actually industry ready? Which I just said. Industry readiness is very important. It is not the theoretical, subjects what you learn. No. That is needed. That is, I won't say it is not needed. It is needed. But I was very happy when I saw this program, and my apologies that I did not go through the full detail, but when I saw the people whom you have invited to speak is excellent. That includes me also. Anyway, on a serious note, yes, it's excellent because you are getting industry experts to talk to such a large gathering. I have addressed a lot of universities in Pune, or even across the country. But I have never addressed such a large gathering. I should confess, it is normally 100, 200, 300. Now this itself is a great change. This itself is a great beginning which you are doing, because you have to be ready tomorrow to face the challenges. There are two challenges in front of you. One is, how do you set yourself in the industry or wherever organization you go? That's a challenge. That's a challenge which you will face. So second challenge is, wherever you are going, whichever industry you are going, how that industry is to face the challenges. So it's a both. For the engineering graduates, you will know it's a horizontal movement and vertical movement. Both are there. And so to balance in a horizontal movement and a vertical movement, it's not easy. So for you, first challenge is to get a job in a company where and there you go as a management expert. And the second challenge is your company itself is in a vibration mode because of challenges what they face. Now, initiatives like Make in India have to succeed, then we are generating a pool of blue-collared workforce to gainfully employ of our youth. Now, this is what I have been propagating, and I am very happy to say that this, you have an opportunity. Now, I'm not talking about the challenges for the industry. Now, I'm talking about the challenges for you. If you today have a great opportunity, that if you are able to change yourself, adapt yourself, I'm sure you'll be more successful. See, again, I'm going back to my college days. In my college, BITS Pilani, every college has got that, what I call the emblem and the tagline. And my tagline in my college was Gyanam Paramam Balam. Knowledge is power supreme. At that time, yes, there's a fact. Knowledge is power supreme. But today, can I say knowledge is power supreme? I will say, sorry, no. Because I may have knowledge. It's of no use to me is that knowledge if I don't use that. So maybe the application of knowledge is more important than the knowledge itself. So what I'm saying is there is always a paradigm shift in all those facts. So for you today, for you, when you go to an industry, you should see how you can adapt yourself. That is very, very, very important. And the most important point, third important point is, which I am sure with little bit what I knew about Dr. Balasubramaniam, the attitudinal change of the students, how it is actually changed, how it is made. And I should be very honest, I was surprised, pleasantly surprised, initially shocked, when somebody was just mentioning to me, you work 24/7, 365 days a year. Is it right?
Yes, sir.
You love it?
Yes, sir.
You can't say no now, no? but it's a great, great learning for me because, and like what you just now echoed, because if somebody, if it was not so happy, somebody in the corner would have said no, but I didn't even hear a faint no. And the person who told me, the students who are telling me, they are telling me with a lot of passion, a lot of feeling. So So this itself is a great change. Now it is up to the managers of tomorrow to turn the challenges into opportunities. Now here is the place for you. Here is the place for you. And here, if you really are, you know, dovetailing yourself to face the challenges, the three parameters, as I mentioned again, in terms of technology, macroeconomics, and finance, that is taken over by the organization. But this human resources is taken over by individuals. Individuals. I'm telling you, individuals. You will realize when you go to an industry that every individual is different. You would have studied in the same college, you would have studied in the, you may be having the same marks, you may be same brothers or sisters, or you may be twins, but still you will find there is a difference in your attitude. So, what I wanted to say, the challenges of tomorrow, business challenges, what today we are facing, and which will increase. It's not going to come down. Challenges are not going to come down at all. For that, you have a very important role to play. I will just take you before I close. I have to tell something which I started the story. Just to give you a small thing about the company where I work today. I work in a company called Walchandnagar Industries and how we are tackling these challenges. This is a 108-year-old company, nationalistic company. Said Walchand Hirachand was actually, Sardar Patel used to call him a patriotic industrialist. And many people think that we are into the sugar industry, we set up a sugar plant. Yes, we also set up sugar plants, but we are very much there into critical areas of defense, nuclear, aerospace. Many of you may not know that the company called HAL, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, I'm sure Dr. Balasubramanian will know about that. HAL is is the largest defense public sector in the country. The largest defense public sector in the company. That was started by Walchand Hirachand. And there's a very interesting anecdote to it, which perhaps may give you a feeling about the ethics of this group. During the Second World War, the Japanese had actually come up to Burma, and the next stop for the Japanese was conquering Burma and coming to India. So the British government told Walchand Hirachand that in case the Japanese come to India, they didn't want to give them on a platter a aircraft manufacturing company with a runway. The Bangalore airport, if anybody has gone, not now, about 10 years back, the old runway was part of the HAL runway. Said Walchand Hirachand said, "Sir, my job is to only create, I do not destruct." Because British government said, "You will have to destruct this unit, you will have to just blast it." So he says, "I only create," and that is how British government took over this company during the Second World War. What I am saying is the company has been very patriotic. How do we, just to give an example in my company, yes, we are faced with these type of challenges on a day in and day out. Technology, constant innovation in our manufacturing process. That has to be done. Today, if I am making an item with, say, 10 hours of this item, I have to see how can I make it in 9 hours or 8 hours or 9.5 hours. So there is a requirement of innovation in manufacturing processes, strength in engineering, dialogue with customers to remain abreast with regard to the changing technology. If you are not in touch with what is happening, you will not be able to withstand the sudden change. So this is important. Value addition to products through technology and reverse engineering. So this is how we face the challenges. In terms of macroeconomic, dedicated teams to understand the key policy level changes. As I said, the macroeconomic changes. Suddenly there is a GST has come. How is it going to impact my organization? It could be a small shop. It could be a large industry. The impact is an impact. Understand the impact on business segments. Selectively focus on business with
future growth, feedback from customers, vendors, and respond accordingly, pricing and buying cost. Financial, sustained focus on cost realization, zero-based budgeting, focus on faster cash-churning business, innovative ways of structured financing, and optimal usage of cash resources. These are some of the various, you know, methods on facing the challenge. Human resource programs for management trainees, for GET, DET, skill upgradation of workmen, opportunities for young leaders. In our organization, we have actually, you know, made a talent pool. We and I, at the senior most level as MD CEO, look into even the every graduate trainee who joins the company, have regular interaction with them. First line officers, we have regular interaction with them. And we spot. It's very easy. No, normally in many places, you have a growth like this. But if you have to face challenges, if a person has got that attitude, that aptitude, both are there, he has to be spotted and given a separate push so that he is able to face the challenges. Structured orientation and rotation of talent management across the organization. So, without, this was part of the slide. I want to talk just about two or three points. Somebody did mention sales gives the revenue. Okay. Now the question is revenue important or is profit important? Okay. So that's a very important point. Revenue, well, yes, revenue you need it. But when in terms of usefulness, it's a very difficult. Earlier, people used to think, I'm a 400 crore company, I have to become a 600 crore company, I have to become a 1,000 crore company, I have to become a 10,000 crore company. Yes, growth is needed. Without growth, if you are stagnant, you are dead. Fine. But at the same time, growth at what cost? Not at the cost of profitability. Many times, people used to think, you know, I had the opportunity of working both in a private sector and a public sector. I have worked 26 years in a public sector and almost 18 years in a private sector. People have a notion that a private sector man makes more profit. There's a notion. And a public sector should not make profit. I think that's an absolutely wrong thinking. You do business for profit. You don't do business for charity. The only difference is, as in Hindi they say, Munafa or Munafa Khori. There are different. Profit and profiteering. That is important. So profit, to answer that gentleman's question, yes, it is not the sales. It is rather the profit. How the profit comes, I'll again come. I'll come to that because that is very important. You should realize because when you go to an organization tomorrow, for you to be successful, you should know what the organization is expecting out of you. And if you are ready-made, trained, your mindset is trained that way, then you will definitely be more successful than a counterpart who doesn't have those thought process. Sometime back, earlier, maybe 30, 40, 50 years back, you are right, 100% right, it's the salespeople who used to, which used to feel that the profitability of the organization is made by the salespeople because they think that the salespeople can increase the price or reduce the price. No. Today, what's happening is it's basically the sale price is decided by the market. You cannot even make a change into that. The manufacturing technology is same. You have the same machine, same materials available everywhere. So one of the areas where there, which is gaining importance, which is really gaining importance, is supply chain management. Supply chain management today gains an importance in increasing the profits of the organization in which way, in the best optimum method, like the Japanese started the zero inventory. So similarly, supply chain management. Another area which is very crucial, very important, for the business today is financial management. How you manage your finance? That's equally important. And in a change scenario, change business scenario where there's a lot of challenges, it is very crucial how the finance person's brain goes. And you as young management graduates who are definitely going to enter into the professional world, one of the things which you should really do, never, you know, many a time people think that, yes, I come from a business school, I had to go at a cushy job. It's a cushy job. It will be a cushy job. You can make it more cushy job. But important thing for you is to see how you analyze. What is the difference between a business management graduate and an engineering graduate? One of the biggest difference is you are expected to analyze and then take results. And that analytical capability, if you are able to generate in you, I'm sure you'll be successful. My time is about to be over. I think it's up to one. So I'll just take one point. I started my story saying that in any organization, only two people matter. One who sells and one who makes. You remember the story or you forgot? You forgot. And who is important? Sales. Good. So we said there are only two people who matter, one who sells and one who makes. And between the two, it is the man, or it's the person, I'm not being gender specific, it's the person who sells is more important because even he can even sell ideas. Ladies and gentlemen, today the success of any industry, any organization, any institution is depending on only one. It's not the sales, it's not the manufacturing, it's not the supply chain, it's not the finance. It is you, it's the people. And I'm telling you with full sincerity and experience that today HR, the human resources, is the only resource which can make a company go up or go down. So you have a great opportunity. The way you are trained today in this environment, if you go to an industry tomorrow, and I am sure you will be able to give your maximum with your full passion and full attitude. So the most crucial and important thing in facing any business challenges, any business situation, business dynamics, is the people. And for that, ladies and gentlemen, you get prepared, get ready. My best wishes to all of you. And once again, I would like to thank Professor Balasubramaniam, Dr. Archana Srivastav, for giving me this opportunity to come and talk to all of you. Thank you very much.